there's a ton of noise out there. So how do you get decision makers to pay attention to your brand? Start a podcast and invite your ideal clients to be guests on your show. Learn more at sweetfishmedia.com.
You're listening to B2B Growth, a daily podcast for B2B leaders. We've interviewed names you've probably heard before, like Gary Vaynerchuk and Simon Sinek, but you've probably never heard from the majority of our guests. That's because the bulk of our interviews aren't with professional speakers and authors. Most of our guests are in the trenches leading sales and marketing teams. They're implementing strategy. They're experimenting with tactics. They're building the fastest growing B2B companies in the world. My name is James Carberry. I'm the founder of Sweetfish Media, a podcast agency for B2B brands, and I'm also one of the co-hosts of this show. When we're not interviewing sales and marketing leaders, you'll hear stories from behind the scenes of our own business. We'll share the ups and downs of our journey as we attempt to take over the world. Just kidding. Well, maybe. Let's get into the show.
All right. We'd love to welcome to the show Andy Clayton, who is the lead coach in Europe of Petra Coach and former CEO of LNP China, which he had acquired and successfully able to build and then sell that company after scaling it up very successfully. And now is coaching other businesses to do the same. Andy, welcome to the show.
Hi, Rex. It's a pleasure to be here.
Andy, would you do us a favor and introduce your company, Petra Coach, and what you're doing today?
Sure. So Petra Coach helps scale up companies to grow, to increase their top line, bottom line revenue. Particularly, it's through engaging teams, creating alignment amongst teams around having core priorities set for each quarter. And it's all done using a methodology and a bunch of tools from a book called Scaling Up. So I use the scale up tools in my own company to scale the business up. And over the years, built up the expertise and now help other people, other companies to do the same thing.
Yeah, that's excellent. And we're hoping to draw on some of that experience today as we talk about this idea that, that you and I had gone back and forth on of when a leader has to hand over the reins of a department to someone else, right? So specifically in your experience, having been the CEO, having started a business, being an entrepreneur, and having to hand over the reins of sales to a sales leader, what a big leap that is and kind of how to navigate that properly. Do you want to give a little background on what you did with LNP China to kind of set the stage here?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, I mean, the first part of that is who to hand the reins over to. And a lot of people struggle with the question of how can I find a salesman for my company that is going to be able to bring in and close leads? And it's hard because you need industry experience and you need sales skills.
Yep.
And people that have both of those are rare and expensive. So if you go looking on the market, you could find it's a lot of people are out of their budget. So what I did is I had a guy who was running operations for me who was a really good performer. Now, it aligned with his personal plans in life that he also wanted to move back to our target market, to the UK. But he had all the potential to be a salesman. He just didn't have the experience.
Sure.
And need a business inside out. So what we did is we moved him to be head of sales and we brought in a new person to run operations. And that way we didn't have to hire for both skill sets at once, if that makes sense.
Sure, but two big scary moves for you as a CEO. This is great.
Yeah, absolutely. Now the background to it was I went to a training one time in Dublin and there's a guy called Jack Daly who's a sales coach. And I hated most of the day and I found Jack very difficult to listen to. Sorry, Jack, if he's in any way involved in your podcast. But the one thing that he said that just totally struck home for me was he said that the original sin of an entrepreneur is that the CEO, the entrepreneur, is head of sales and has the idea in their head that when I reach that level of sales there, that's when I'm going to hire a head of sales.
Sure.
This is the wrong way around. He says, the only way you're going to reach that level there is if you hire a head of sales and that's the person that's going to take you there. And I was in exactly that situation. You know, I wanted to scale the company and grow it. And I thought that I had to grow before I could afford to bring that person on board and I had things the wrong way around. So I took the leap of faith, you know, and my approach to it. So being an entrepreneur is psychologically, it's challenging. It's tough, right? Because you're always having to risk your own money on things. Mm-hmm. And so the approach I had to it was, well, I'm going to make sure that I've got enough cash in the business so that if this totally doesn't work out and this bombs, I can still cover payroll and expenses, and you know the business isn't going to fail as a result. But I'm going to build up enough cash so that I can pay somebody to come in for at least 3 months. And even if they don't sell anything for the first 3 months, I'll still be able to pay them. And if nothing's happened, I can fire them and I'm back to where I started. But assuming things work out, then they'll start to pay for themselves within 3 months, and then you know, we're up and running. So I built up enough cash reserve, and then I worked with the headhunter, and we brought a guy in, and I was fortunate in that it really did work out, and it was an inflection point in the business, and that's when the company really started to grow up and scale.
Sure. Well, and that makes sense. You can only, there's only so much time in the day. There's only so many decisions that you're truly the expert on. So handing over those things, those components of your business that you truly can't continue to scale, it makes sense. Now, that obviously changed your role from someone who both ran the business and ran the sales to someone who almost a completely different job. Do you want to describe kind of that transition?
Yeah. If you've been running your own company and you've built it up to the kind of size where you can afford to do these things, you have sales skills, right? You're able to sell mm-hmm. what you do. So, you know, a lot of entrepreneurs quite rightly believe that I'm the person that can sell what we do the best. Sure. And normally that's true. You know, there's truth in that statement. Now, and in my case, I still, you know, I have the ego to believe that that is still true.
Sure.
However, that doesn't mean that I'm the right person to be doing it, you know? And also I personally, I quite like doing sales, but it's not really my own natural personality or fit or skill set. And I was always more comfortable on the operational side of the business. So I think that played to my advantage in this case, because I didn't want to be a salesman all my life.
Sure.
But yeah, of course my role changed. And whereas previously I was the one actually making the sales and having all those conversations, I ended up having to be the one that was guiding somebody to build a process. And so a lot of it became about, again, this goes back to Jack Daney. A lot of he teaches about creating what in America you call a sales playbook. We mm-hmm. call it a sales manual over here.
Sure.
It's about breaking the sales process down to its component steps to say, and in our case, we had about 4 or 5 steps from initially creating a lead to then having an initial conversation to a proposal to a contract and to finally closing. And then what is the call to action at each stage and what are the scripts that help you get that? But it forced me to have to look at that process and to design and describe each part of it so that somebody else could do it effectively. And then what was interesting about what happened, obviously, the process of forcing me to do that then meant that my sales guy and myself together found all sorts of opportunities for improving the process. For example, we realized that if we brought in a contract in the first conversation, then we could screen out a whole bunch of unqualified leads and we could actually cut out entire steps from the process. So like I say, removing me from the process actually made the process better, even though I still think I was the best guy at doing it.
Today's growth story is all about search engine marketing. The company we're highlighting is Sentinel One. This challenger cybersecurity brand was set out to disrupt the endpoint protection space. Their brand was top-notch, their product was innovative, but they were struggling to gain traction online in an already developed industry. Then they found Directive Consulting, a B2B search marketing agency. Within the first quarter of working with Directive, Sentinel One was able to increase their organic traffic by 128%. And overall lead volume by an outstanding 251%. Now, I have a hunch that Directive can get these kind of results for you too. So head over to directiveconsulting.com and request a totally free custom proposal. That's directiveconsulting.com. All right, let's get back to this interview.
Sure. Well, I think there's the component of the passion, of the true understanding of the pain that you're solving for, you know, of the value of the business that you can communicate most effectively. But there is an element to sales that I find really interesting. I think this is true of any role that we're trying to teach someone else to perform successfully. There is a process element to it. Even, you know, listening to people who are creative, who have a process for their creativity that they have to follow, enabling someone else to follow in their footsteps really does require us to think very carefully and strategically about what happens in each stage of that journey. That's very smart. So if I'm hearing you right, so far what we've learned is you have to make the decision ultimately that you want to grow your business and that you're committed to handing that over. You were smart enough to build up a cash reserve, which I think was very wise. Obviously, it worked out well for you. So that you could go back to where you were. You know, worst case scenario, you're back to starting point, and that's okay because your business was successful. And then you had to understand what the process was, really document it, and then that allowed you to find greater success in optimization. Am I tracking so far?
Yeah, and I'd just love to add something to that.
Sure.
I want to share with you, because these days I work with a whole load of other companies, right? And a position that I see so many companies stuck at is, so Jeffrey Gitomer, he mentions this in like the Sales Bible and some of his books. Mm-hmm. He says, go to these companies and they say, almost proudly, we've always just grown through referral.
Sure.
Natural referral and people recommend us, and then our customers grow, and therefore we've grown. And I don't think that is a point of it's proud in that people are happy with you and they've stuck with you, and that's great.
Sure.
But in a way, that's not a real business. That's lacking an entire function, right? You don't have the ability to grow in the sales function. But what goes wrong in those companies is that they follow their customers' wants. So yeah. Rather than becoming expert at just one narrow small thing that they do, they become quite generous because their customers say, well, you know, could you do this for us? And so if they're an accounting firm, they say, oh, well, we need some tax, and then we need some wealth management, and then we need some, you know, bookkeeping, and we need all these various things. Can you do this? Can you do this? Yes, 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 yes. Is that the company loses direction strategically. Whereas from my story just now, what you can hear in that is that when you create a dedicated sales department that's actually going after customers, you have to define, okay, who is the core customer? What is the product that we're selling? You know, and you can't just change it at whim like you can do when it's the CEO selling stuff himself, having those personal relationships with the client. So it's an important inflection point in the business, not just for growth, but also for focus and strategic direction. And, you know, so when I advise people these days, so you've got to get a sales head of sales in to help you grow sales. It's not just because that's going to help them grow sales, but it's also going to force them to make those difficult trade-offs to say, right, well, we're not going to do that. I'm not going to do that. We're going to pick our niche. Because yep. Ultimately, I believe from a strategy point of view, less is more. It's through being narrow and having a good, strong strategic focus that you then unlock growth.
Absolutely. There's a great book on that called Essentialism, The Disciplined Pursuit of Less. That's one of a favorite of my co-founder, and I love that book. I think it talks exactly about that point, right?
I've read that book, and yeah, it's a good one.
Yeah, less is more here, and you're able to really narrow down and say what you're experts at. I think that's great. And very sage advice, like let's not just let the customers control everything, because I think it was Henry Ford who said, if I had asked people what they wanted before I built the Model T, they would have said faster horses, right? So that it's not necessary that they're always giving you the best advice of where your company should go or even what products your company should build. So very, very wise. As we're looking at, look, we've handed over the reins. We've got somebody who is in control of this thing. I'm sure it's very tempting to just say, nope, not working out. This isn't working. This is, you know what? You messed up one time too many, or one time is too many. How do you let go of the constant need to control the perfection of that system? You know, you've obviously documented it. You're confident in what it is and how you do it. Now somebody else has failed in some element of that. Obviously there's critical failure points, but let's say it's not a critical failure point. How do you let go of those things and accept that?
That's a great question. I'm, you know, one of the happiest days in my business. And I don't know, I wonder how people react to this as a statement. One of the happiest days in my business is when we had a client that had come in. I wasn't involved in lead generation. I wasn't involved in selling and closing that client. And I wasn't involved in operating them. In fact, I knew nothing about them other than the name because they, you know, sales calls.
Sure.
And that was a moment of pride for me because I built a company whereby other people bringing in serving clients and growing the business. The problem is, you know, other people are also representing me in the market and in those client relationships, and things go wrong. And so, again, you know, I can remember my own sort of reservation about that at the time, and what I see is fear with other people that I work in is this perfectionism that creeps in and says, well, I would never want to put my name to anything that wasn't perfect. And that's a problem, right? I mean, that's wonderful objective to have, but it's just not realistic. As soon as you accept that you want to have scale, then you accept that there's going to have to be imperfection. And, you know, I like to counsel excellence as much as the next man, but myself, and also I see the same in other entrepreneurs, we often don't get stuck on, you know, thriving for excellence. We are stuck on actually perfectionism. And letting go means that things are going to go wrong. And so it means having to sometimes pick up the pieces, but it's being forgiving to the members of the team. It's not biting heads off. And just remembering at the back of your mind, I'm kind of doing this for the greater good. Okay, we've screwed up today, but what we're building is something that's bigger and is going to be able to do what we do on a wider stage. And like I say, reaching that day when you've got customers that come in that you haven't touched in any way, that's a beautiful moment. And that's, I think that's a real coming of age moment.
Sure. And I think it's a great way to apply the lean startup methodology or the principle of like, let's just ship something and we know it's good because we know it solves a problem. And maybe it doesn't solve it perfectly. The same idea, not on the product side, but on the sales and even on the marketing side, I'm sure it's the same. Okay, somebody else is putting our brand message out there. It's communicating the values that we hold near and dear to our hearts, the people who started this thing, and accepting that maybe they're not going to communicate it perfectly, but they're going to get 90% of the way there. I think that's great. And clearly it worked out for you, Andy. I mean, this is obviously a testament to the fact that imperfection is, if it's acceptable, that it can breed greater success. But perfectionism can just make us kind of sit on our hands and just wait around until everything is just so.
But let me tell you the end of the story, though. And this is just my very own personal story. Is my role changed to the point whereby it's the Peter principle, and I ended up doing a thing that I wasn't very good at anymore. No, really. So I was very, very good at running operations in my company. I was actually pretty good at running sales. But a CEO is a different role. And a CEO at heart actually is a people-focused role. And what you have to do every day is influence and coach and take care of people in the same way that, you know, almost like a father taking care of a family.
Sure.
And I just didn't like doing that very much. And I don't think I was that good at it. And, you know, people sometimes would leave, you know, because I just didn't have maybe the depth of relationship and loyalty with them that role requires and demands. And so I got fed up with it. And ultimately, that's why I ended up exiting and setting my company, because that was a role that was sort of so different from, I always thought I'd wanted to be a CEO.
Sure. And
I kind of had to do that in my life. But when I got there, I realized, you know what, maybe I'm not the right man for this.
Yeah, it's always interesting to see that when you can say, look, I've built something that can be sustained by someone else. And I'm sure there was some pains of parting there, but also some excitement, right? That this company has its own legs, that it can continue to grow without you, is so exciting. So, I mean, hats off to you for that success. And now that you're with Petra Coach, you're helping others find that same success. Andy, if others want to find you online, where do they find you and Petra Coach?
Sure. Well, we're at petracoach.com. I'm up on the website. My details are there. I'm on LinkedIn. I'm Andy Clayton at petracoach.com. Anyone particularly around Europe, obviously, you have some slots for new members over here, and I'm happy to share what it is that we do and how we can help companies to grow.
Excellent. Well, we appreciate you being on the show, Andy.
Thank you very much, Rex. I've really enjoyed it.
Becoming a thought leader doesn't just happen. If you want to build a strong personal brand and extend your reach online and offline, you need a plan. Want help developing yours? Check out Impact Summit. This one-day event is bringing together best-selling authors, professional athletes, influential CEOs, and emerging entrepreneurs, all for one purpose: to equip you to lead, influence, and inspire. Whether you're looking to build a lasting legacy with your business or extend the reach of your brand, Impact Summit speakers will share inspiring stories and practical lessons to help you on your way. Did we mention a session on launching and growing a podcast? You guessed it. You'll hear from Sweetfish Media's own James Carberry during that session. You won't want to miss all of these influencers and leaders coming together in Salt Lake City on October 13th. Ready to learn more? Check out influencerinc.co/impactsummit. B2B Growth listeners can get 15% off the price of their tickets for this event by using the promo code SWEETFISH. SWEETFISH. So use that code, get your tickets today, and get ready to grow your brand and your influence at Impact Summit 2018.